Today I'm going to try to make one of the most influential administrative law Supreme Court cases fun. Phew, I've got my work cut out for me. We're going full hipster on you guys and talking about a case you've probably never heard of. Chevron v. NRDC. You know who has heard of it though? Brett Kavanaugh and Neil Gorsuch. And this case is literally their archenemy. If this was a samurai film, this case killed their father. In fact, the Federalist Society as a whole comes out consistently against the court's decision, which established something called Chevron deference.
Some court watchers say another issue could be just as important. It's known as the Chevron deference. It allows federal agencies to interpret ambiguous statutes, and federal courts must defer to their rulings. Some have recently pushed back at the ruling, indicating that the Trump administration, as well as Justice Gorsuch and the late Antonin Scalia, say no more.
So what case is this? Chevron versus the Natural Resources Defense Council, a case that took place in 1984 and massively expanded what government agencies can do. 1984? Government expansion? Coincidence? Definitely. So what happened? Well, we've all heard of the oil company Chevron Texaco, a company that generally mixes with environmental policy like oil and water. The problem here is that Chevron was just giving too much money to charity and not leaving anything for the shareholders, and I'm just kidding, they were polluting. A lot. In America, we have a Clean Air Act.
The Clean Air Act of 1970 is regarded as the most comprehensive air pollution control bill in American history.
The Clean Air Act required specific states to establish a permit program regulating new or modified stationary sources of air pollution. I know, so far this sounds about as scandalous as getting a copy of Trump's tax returns and finding out he always takes a penny and never leaves a penny. But bear with me. The question here is, what is a source of pollution? Sounds simple enough, but when you get to the Supreme Court, they overanalyze acts like a vengeful high school English teacher. The act just said sources and assumed people could figure out what that meant. But different EPA administrators governed in radically different ways because of the ambiguity. You see, traditionally the EPA, not any official act, just the people from the EPA reading this act, defined a source as any device in a manufacturing plant that produced pollution. Then Ronald Reagan came riding horseback into the White House and his EPA chief, Ann Gorsuch, Neil Gorsuch's mom, looked at that and said, nope, here's a new definition that allowed an existing plant to get permits for new equipment that did not meet standards, as long as the total emissions from the plant itself did not increase. Man, someone's Thanksgiving is gonna be awkward this year. Neil, will you pass the potatoes? Oh, and stop saying what your mom did was unconstitutional. Now, if you're rubbing your chin wondering, is that a good thing or a bad thing for the environment? Just know that the National Resources Defense Council sued the EPA, saying that this interpretation ran contrary to the Clean Air Act, and Chevron, the oil company, came in to defend the EPA. Nothing suspicious there. With that, let's begin.
We'll hear arguments next in Chevron against Natural Resources Council.
Now there were two questions facing the court, the legal question and the precedent question. Legally, was the EPA allowed to define the term stationary source to mean whole industrial plants, which would allow plants to modify themselves without permits that were required under the Clean Air Act, which I know, exciting, right? Regarding precedent, though, the question was whether a federal agency can write its own restrictions in the gray area of acts. Well, it doesn't say we can't do it. Specifically in this case...
Now, Part D does not itself define what is a source for purposes of activating this NSR program. And in fact, the agency has ever since 1977 assume that it has some discretion in how to define what counts as a source.
In doing any sort of regulating, the agency had to assume some definition of what a source is. Otherwise, it would be like giving a speeding ticket to a philosopher. What really is a speed limit? We're on a planet spinning thousands of miles an hour, traveling 67,000 miles per hour through the universe. Clearly, me going 60 in a school zone, it's all relative. Quick legal disclaimer, don't do that unless you want to be explaining your interpretation of Chevron deference to the pavement. So where do you get the definition for the word source? Well, there were a few different opinions. First,
you say the statute does not define the term source, and your opponents say it does.
Part D quote, does not define source.
But then does the definition of stationary source in section 111?
That is one of the big disputes in the case.
Oh, so it's an issue as to whether that...
Whether that definition...
They don't agree with you then that there's no definition.
Elsewhere in the Act, source was defined in a way that specifically goes against the definition of the more environmentally lax interpretation that the EPA had adopted. So, use that definition, right? It's not like when writing the Act, Congress decided, you know what, let's put a definition here and leave the word intentionally ambiguous elsewhere. Now this seems like an uphill battle for Chevron, right?
Of course, the language of the definition tends to cut against you somewhat, I think. Because it's any building or any facility. And you would say that if you've got three buildings in a plant, that you don't count the building separately. Right?
That definition is so specific, it's almost like Congress suspected this exact thing would happen. So, just to make sure we're all on the same page here, in defining terms for a different section, Congress specifically defined the word source to be referring to individual buildings as opposed to the entire plant. So why not just port this definition over? Well, Team Chevron EPA had two rebuttals to this. First,
the fact is that the way that definition works in the 1970 NSPS program would be very different. That is, to carry it over would not make much functional sense, because that's a very different program.
Remember how the Clean Air Act was massive? Well, the section with a source definition in it described a very different program. It would be like telling your wife, it's not cheating because my last girlfriend let me do it. Definitions aren't like scarves in this case. One size doesn't fit all. In a similar vein,
Section 111 definition itself says, for purposes of this section.
That's right, the definition specifically says, for use in this section only. So, clearly that definition is probably not going to work. Which means we've explained our way into an even trickier problem. Who's going to define this word? Unfortunately, they didn't seize on the only opportunity for a thoughtful speech to ever start with, Webster's Dictionary defines blank as... Instead, you had two schools of thought. The first, led by Sandra Day O'Connor, argued,
well, I guess the question is whether Congress has mandated that, that's all. It's really not for us to determine which policy makes the more sense.
She said that we should try and figure out what Congress intended to accomplish at face value when they passed the act. I emphasize at face value because I'm sure things like voter fraud acts, she would want to have interpreted on the basis of cutting down on voter fraud, as opposed to the alleged desire to disenfranchise voters. It was pretty clear that Congress had intended the Clean Air Act to cut down on air pollution. What? For hardcore Supreme Court junkies, I just want to take a second to acknowledge that, yes, in these oral arguments there was plenty of debates as to exactly what Congress had desired. And whether the Team Chevron EPA decision would actually lead to less pollution. But most people watching this are more concerned with the legacy of this decision rather than what the modern day permitting process for air polluters is. So I'm skipping over some pretty big swaths of arguments here. You should thank me, the National Resource Defense Council lawyer was about as charismatic as a particularly boring rock. All you need to know is that, looking at the other definition from the different section, as well as the reasons Congress overall passed this, the consensus was that Congress's primary goal was to cut down on air pollution. On the other hand, people were saying,
even if the definition applies, the most sensible reading of it is that within the definition, there is room to adapt it and that the Congress must have intended some administrative discretion to adapt it to the functional needs of the various Clean Air Act programs.
Yeah, who cares what Congress thinks? It's up to the agency to define the undefined in whatever way they see fit. I mean, they're the ones on the ground and Lord knows nobody's saying, you know what? I really wish Congress, a group with 73% disapproval ratings, had more power to run things. So, what happened? Well, you can probably guess if you've been paying even half attention. But in an odd smattering of votes, with three justices abstaining from voting or writing the decision, the court voted in favor of Team Chevron EPA. Writing, in these cases, the administrator's interpretation represents a reasonable accommodation of manifestly competing interests, and is entitled to deference. What kind of deference?
Skepticism of Chevron deference, and that we ought to maybe tip the balance back toward relying on Congress, or the intent of Congress at least.
Chevron deference. And this is no small issue. Chevron deference became legend in legal circles. Between the 34 years from 1984 to 2018, Chevron deference has been cited more than 81,000 times. That comes to 6.5 times a day, every day for the last 34 years. It brought us Obamacare. Turns out a plausible interpretation of a rule that said when a state doesn't set up its own marketplace, the federal government shall establish and operate such an exchange, when you interpret such a way, gives the federal government the ability to subsidize all state markets. The ACA, sponsored by Chevron. That's right, Chevron might have given us cheaper health insurance. What have you done for me lately, Shell? It also influenced Dodd-Frank, a ton of immigration, war on drugs, and trade laws. Basically, if you're an agency with a good lawyer, you're good to go. Thank you, and that's all I have to say about that. Hello, YouTube. I hope you enjoyed this video. If you want to support independent, nonpartisan comedy news, remember to subscribe by clicking on this floating logo to the right of my head. Or do it the old-fashioned way by clicking the subscribe button below. Ring that bell so that freedom will continue to ring, and remember to give me a thumbs up. Lastly, as always, thank you for watching.